Can I use one of these bar stools, sir, back here?
Sure.
Great. I usually lecture from a bar stool at Westminster, and it was kind of tempting when I saw it. If it doesn't drop me too low. I think that's, can you still see me? I went to the Masters conference this year at John MacArthur's church, and he has a pulpit that comes up out of the floor. Now, my church, we meet in a converted bowling alley, so I'd never seen anything like it, but the guy, one of the guys who got up to speak, the pulpit malfunctioned. This guy's about 5'3", I think, and the pulpit malfunctioned and just kept rising up until you couldn't see him. He was trapped. So, okay, my computer is malfunctioning. My computer's malfunctioning here, so I'm going to close it down and restart it and see if that works. In the meantime, I will just ad lib for a few moments, if you can bear with me. Just as an aside, two things. I have a vague New Zealand connection. My youngest sister has a Maori name. She's Nio. I've never met anybody else with that name until I saw this week somebody on television with that name. So my sister has a Maori name. And thinking about the emergency advice we just received reminded me of growing up as a child in the 70s in Britain at school, when we would have these what to do in the event of a nuclear disaster routines, where apparently if they dropped a nuclear bomb, if the Russians dropped a nuclear bomb on Gloucester, which was about 12 miles away, in order to avoid the sort of 6,000 degree temperatures and the 800 mile an hour winds, what we were taught to do was crouch under our desks with our hands over our heads. And it was this idea that, oh yeah, everything will be just fine as these winds zoom across. So let me just, it looks like my computer is now working. I thought it was. Yeah. I want to talk to you in this second hour about preaching. And set it against the background of what I've said so far about the church being an act of God's grace. I think that there is much confusion about preaching that is driven on the whole by a failure to understand that preaching is of theological significance. Remember being in preaching in a church some years ago when I was a visiting preacher, and wasn't in America, but I won't say. All I'll say, it's in a country not far from New Zealand, but which isn't actually New Zealand. There aren't many countries that are not far from New Zealand, of course. And as we get to the point in the service where the sermon is to take place, the person leading worship that morning stood up and said, "Okay, we'll take a coffee break now. And we'll reconvene in 10 minutes when Truman will explain the Bible to us." And it struck me that there was a wealth of theology that underlay that move. I knew immediately which particular theological college had influenced this person. And it also struck me that talking about preaching as explaining the Bible was interesting, because preaching should never be less than explaining the Bible. But if the goal of the preacher is simply to explain the Bible, then people would be better off reading books. There's not a lot of point in me preaching on a Sunday if all I'm doing is explaining the Bible, because actually there are other people out there who've written books that explain the Bible much better than I could ever do. And it would be better for me to direct those people to those books than to stand up and explain the Bible to them. I want to suggest that preaching, like the church, is what in Presbyterian terms we'd call a means of grace. That is, preaching is a means by which God does something. It's his chosen means of doing something for the congregation. I think it's the case that if the word is not being properly preached in a church, then pretty much everything else will end up being dysfunctional at some level over time. And I also think that understanding what preaching is critical to doing it well. I referred earlier on to the fact that, you know, you can do something, you can do something well, but when you understand what it is that you're doing, you might be able to do it even better and more intentionally. And that applies both, I think, to those who preach and those who listen. Got some quotations here from historic documents relative to the importance of preaching. Martin Luther, in 1522, Martin Luther returns to Wittenberg. He's been in the Wartburg Castle after the Diet of Worms. His own men, the men of Frederick the Wise, kidnap him and take him out of the public eye for nearly 12 months in order to allow the dust to settle and also for Luther's own safety. But rioting breaks out in Wittenberg in December 1521. And in 1522, early 1522, Luther returns to Wittenberg. And it's at this point in Luther's career that he's most vulnerable. We often think, when we think of Martin Luther, that he's at his most vulnerable at the Diet of Worms, when he's on trial, in a sense, for his life. But actually, he's in even more danger in early 1522, because if he can't bring the rioting under control by sheer force of personality, then Frederick the Wise, his princely protector, will abandon him. He'll have to do that in order to prevent the emperor taking military action against Wittenberg. So Luther is at his most vulnerable, and he preaches a series of remarkable sermons in Wittenberg that restore calm to the streets. And in one of those sermons, he makes a comment about the power of the word, and he says this: "I will preach it, teach it, write it, but I will constrain no man by force, for faith must come freely without compulsion. Take myself as an example. I opposed indulgences and all the papists, but never with force. I simply taught, preached, and wrote God's word. Otherwise, I did nothing. And while I slept or drank Wittenberg beer with my friends Philip and Amsdorf, the word so greatly weakened the papacy that no prince or emperor ever inflicted such losses upon it. I did nothing. The word did everything." Quoted that when I spoke at the Masters Conference this year, and somebody watching online emailed a very angry email to me complaining that I had stood in Dr. MacArthur's pulpit and mentioned beer in a positive context. So if there's anybody out there, this is a Presbyterian college, I think I can mention beer and get away with it. Luther's point there, though, is preaching is powerful. He has this confidence that if the word is proclaimed, the word will be powerful. One of my favorite modern theologians, not somebody whose theology as a whole I would endorse, but whose writings on preaching I found particularly important and significant. Indeed, it was this man. If you read Martin Lloyd-Jones's biography, Lloyd-Jones is changed from a preacher of regeneration to a preacher of the cross by reading Peter Taylor Forsyth's little book, The Cruciality of the Cross. Well, Forsyth also wrote a book, Positive Preaching and the Modern Mind, which, although he's very in favor of some strongly higher critical views of the Bible, I still think is one of the best books ever written on the power of preaching. Forsyth begins this book, which originally delivered as a series of lectures at the Lyman Beecher lectures at Yale Divinity School. P.T. Forsyth opens these lectures by saying this: "It is perhaps an overbold beginning, but I will venture to say that with its preaching, Christianity stands or falls. This is surely so, at least in those sections of Christendom which rest less upon the church than upon the Bible. Wherever the Bible has primacy, which is given it in Protestantism, their preaching is the most distinctive feature of worship." So for Forsyth, preaching was the central hallmark of Protestant worship, and it was a reflection of the primacy that the Bible had in the Protestant church. The Second Helvetic Confession of 1566. This was written in Zurich, 1566, by Heinrich Bullinger, who was Huldrych Zwingli's great successor. Chapter 1 of the Second Helvetic Confession says this: Wherefore, when this word of God is now preached in the church by preachers lawfully called, we believe that the very word of God is proclaimed and received by the faithful, and that neither any other word of God is to be invented nor is to be expected from heaven, and that now the word itself which is preached is to be regarded, not the minister that preaches. For even if he be evil and a sinner, nevertheless the word of God remains still true and good. Notice that very strong opening. Wherefore, when this word of God is now preached in the church by preachers lawfully called, we believe that the very word of God is proclaimed. Bullinger is not there equating preaching with scripture. It's not inspired in the same way, but it is powerful and authoritative. When you think about it, if you were a Christian in the 16th century, you probably wouldn't have been able to read. So your access to the word of God would have come through the public reading and proclamation of the word of God. Say to students, you know, if you judge the health of your Christian life by your quiet time, and I'm very much in favor of quiet times, but if you judge the nature of your Christian life by your quiet time, then you are using a criterion to which most Christians did not have access for most of church history. Because most Christians have not been able to read and write. Their access to the Word of God came through the Word of God read and preached. Larger Catechism, question 155, says this: the Spirit of God maketh the reading, but especially the preaching of the Word, an effectual means of enlightening, convincing, and humbling sinners, of driving them out of themselves and drawing them unto Christ, of conforming them to His image and subduing them to His will, of strengthening them against temptations and corruptions, or building them up in grace and establishing their hearts in holiness and comfort through faith unto salvation. Seems there that the larger catechism envisages preaching to be far more than just explaining the Bible. It is to have a profound impact, a transformative impact. Just as an aside, some people often hear people say this, and it worried me for many years. You know, I don't remember sermons well. I'm concerned that even a week after a sermon, I can't remember what the preacher said. Which I sometimes thought, well, gosh, I'm the preacher, and I can't remember exactly what I said. There are times when I have to flick open the book and say, well, what text did I preach on last Sunday? They're all kind of blurring into each other. I think that when you think about preaching in terms as laid out in the larger catechism, the power of the word preached is transformative. And transformation is often incremental and undiscernible. The analogy I sometimes use is, you know, I was lucky. I went to a state school in the UK, but it was a very good state school. It was an all-boys school. And from the age of 11, I was taught Latin. So I can read Latin now. You hand me a piece of Virgil or a bit of Cicero, and I can work my way through it without too much difficulty. I don't remember any particular Latin lesson. The only lessons at school I remember where somebody pulled off a particularly amazing joke or got into particularly serious trouble. I remember the explosions of the teachers. I don't really remember the classes. But I must have been there because I can read Latin. I know I didn't just develop the ability to read Latin over a period of time through breathing the air or something. I must have sat in a lot of Latin classes, put in a lot of hours. I think we need perhaps to think about preaching that way as well. It's not whether you remember this sermon or that sermon, though all of us, I think, have one or two sermons that had a particular impact on us at a particular point in time. But the impact of sermons is ordinary. It's ordinary and incremental. I like Michael Horton's little book, Ordinary, where he says, you know, Christians are always looking for the spectacular. But actually, the way you grow as a Christian is pretty boring, really. You go to church, take the Lord's Supper, you hear the word preached, you fellowship with Christians, you read the Bible, and you pray. And over time, the Holy Spirit uses all of these means to grow you as a Christian. So, start off by saying preaching is powerful and transformative, but don't look for catastrophic transformation on a week-by-week basis. Sometimes that happens. Sometimes there is somebody perhaps engaged in a particular sin or something, and a single sermon just shatters them. Other times, I think for most of us, the Christian life is one of ordinary discipleship, where we grow week by week under the proclamation of the word. I would set my understanding of preaching against a more general theology of God's speech. God's speech is, I think, creative and powerful. One of the things, the most fundamental things, maybe the first thing we know about God, other than the fact that he exists, is that his creative activity is analogous to speech. Genesis 1, God speaks. God speaks things into being. There was nothing and then there was something, and the discriminating factor is the causal creative speech of God. I've benefited immensely over the years from reading Martin Luther on this. Martin Luther's 1535 lectures on Genesis, very important in this regard. Luther says this, he's speaking here about the fifth day of creation. Who could conceive of the possibility of bringing forth from the water a being which clearly could not continue to exist in water? But God speaks a mere word, and immediately the birds are brought forth from the water. If the word is spoken, all things are possible, so that out of the water are made either fish or birds. And then this is a particularly striking sentence. Therefore, any bird whatever and any fish whatever are nothing but nouns in the divine rule of language. These creatures are nothing but nouns in the divine rule of language. Through this rule of language, those things that are impossible become very easy, while those that are clearly opposite become very much alike, and vice versa. For Luther, God's word was powerfully creative. It permeates Luther's theology. Think about his understanding of justification. The big break that Luther makes with a lot of medieval patterns of justification is this: you are declared to be righteous. It's not an intrinsic, it's not that you are righteous. The Lord sees your righteousness and then declares on the basis of an intrinsic quality that you are righteous. The Lord says a word, you are righteous. And as a result of him speaking that word, then you are righteous in his sight. So Luther has a strong sensitivity to the creative power and priority of the words of God. This is going to be significant later on for what I understand in part preaching to be doing. And I think in a sense we live at a good time for understanding that. Many of us, you know, roll our eyes at political correctness. But the great thing about political correctness is this. Political correctness really understands the creative power of language. When you think about it, the most serious crimes that you can commit these days, by and large, are speech crimes. Racial epithets. Why are racial epithets bad? Because when you use a racial epithet about somebody, it's not simply a description of them. It's an attempt to put them in a certain place. We're acutely aware now that words do shape reality in profound ways. I had the privilege the other week of marrying a couple in my church. You know, and when I say, you know, when in the wedding service the minister says, you know, I now pronounce you man and wife, the words make a difference. The minister is not simply describing something that's happened, he's bringing about something. When you use a racial epithet, when you talk about somebody in sort of gender stereotypical terms, you're putting them in place. You're not simply describing them, you're denigrating them. And on the other side as well, we know that when we use terms, flattering terms, we're not simply describing somebody, we can be encouraging them. We can be putting them in a good place. Luther, I think, is acutely aware that speech functions like that. And of course, for Luther, the one who really speaks reality is God. As I shall say later, I think what we as human beings, we have God-like qualities. One of those is speech, and we're very good at using it in a way that attempts to make us the creator rather than the creature. Brings me to my second point. God's speech connects to the divine image of all the creatures on the face of the earth. Human beings are those who are able to communicate and indeed manipulate their environments through the use of speech. I don't know how many monkeys you can teach to order a cup of tea using plastic symbols. or how many, you know, dolphins you strike up a sort of relationship with through their squeaking. Ultimately, dolphins do not relate to other dolphins in the way that I relate to my wife through speech. Monkey ordering a cup of tea is not the same as a monkey writing the plays of Shakespeare or reflecting upon his own existence. Speech is something that is unique to human beings, and it allows human beings to have a relationship both with each other and, of course, with God, because God speaks to man. Speech is fundamental to that which makes human beings unique. And what is it that makes us unique? Of all the creatures on the face of the earth, we bear the image of God. And theologians debate about whether the image of God is to be seen intrinsically or relationally. I don't see any reason to exclude either. I think that the image of God has various aspects to it, and one of it is our ability to operate with speech. And we see that in the naming of the animals, that God names man and man names every other animal. Naming is a statement of power. It's why if you use a racial epithet about somebody, it's so bad, because you are asserting your superiority to them. But man names the animals in Genesis significant for locating man as he's a little below God, but he's above the other animals. Parents name children. It is a sign of authority. Man is able to use speech, if you like, in a way that is analogous to God's use of speech. Man's speech has a creative aspect to it. He names animals. He makes promises. He makes vows. He issues commands. Man is able to use speech as God is able to use speech as a way of changing reality. So I think the whole idea of speech is very, very important. I would also add, thirdly, to the idea of man as speaking, there is also God's speech as God's primary means of his presence. Now, we know in Scripture God is present in a number of ways. There are theophanies in the Old Testament. There are revelations of God. There are powerful acts through nature. The Shorter Catechism sees God as revealing himself through his works of creation, providence, incarnation. God reveals himself. God is present in various ways. But there is a centrality to God's speech relative to God's presence. Think of Elijah. When God comes to Elijah, he comes in the still, small voice. One of my favorite stories in the whole of the Bible is Elisha and the Shunammite. Remember the story, the Shunammite is this delightful lady who has a sort of apartment built on her house so that when the man of God, Elisha, is passing through town, he doesn't have to worry about where he's going to stay. He can stay with the Shunammite. And as a result of this, the Lord gives this woman who's never been able to have children a child, and the child grows up some and then dies, and she runs to the prophet, and the prophet hands his staff to his servant, and he says, run to the child's room and lay my staff on the child, raise the child from the dead. Don't stop on the way, don't look to the left or the right, don't greet anybody, go straight there and raise the child. And the servant runs off, but the woman won't leave. The woman throws herself at the feet of Elisha and won't leave. Elisha has to go. Why does Elisha have to go? Because God is present through the one who speaks his word there. Where is God present in Israel at that point in time? He's present through the prophet. The country is pretty apostate, but God still speaks through the prophet. God is still present, and this woman needs God to be present in that special way to raise the child. Yes, God is present everywhere metaphysically. God's present in South America, even as the Shunammite is running to the prophet, but God is savingly, powerfully, creatively present through the word of the prophet at that particular point in time. And Luther again sees the fall itself as a struggle between different kinds of word. Who is present as sovereign? Luther, writing on Genesis 3:1, says this: Moses expresses himself very carefully and says, "The serpent said." That is, with a word, it attacks the word. The word which the Lord has spoken to Adam was, "Do not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." For Adam, this word was gospel and law. It was his worship. It was his service and the obedience he could offer God in this state of innocence. These Satan attacks and tries to destroy. Nor is it only his intention, as those who lack knowledge think, to point out the tree and issue an invitation to pick its fruit. He points it out indeed, but then he adds another and a new statement, as he still does in the church. God is powerfully present in Eden through his word, by Satan, the serpent, by presenting another word as an attempt to drive God's authority out of the garden. Calvin institutes too. Says this: it is to be observed that the first man revolted against the authority of God, not only allowing himself to be ensnared by the wiles of the devil, but also by despising the truth and turning aside to lies. Assuredly, when the word of God is despised, all reverence for him is gone. His majesty cannot be duly honored among us, nor his worship maintained in its integrity, unless we hang, as it were, upon his lips. Hence infidelity was at the root of the revolt. And the presence of God through his word is indicated also by the negative, where the absence of God's word is the absence of God. Amos 8:11. "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea, and from north to east. They shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it." And Luther's gloss on that, which I think is correct, says, you know, this is the worst famine of all. All these famines have come, but the worst famine is left till last. There'll be no word of God, no word from God. And that means God is absent from his people. God does not speak. This is picked up, I think, in Mark chapter 1. You'll notice Mark is very careful in his use of choice of words. I'm not sure what the NIV says. Let me see what the NIV does with this verse. It's Mark chapter 1. Yep, the NIV gets it correct, which early versions of the ESV did not. Mark chapter 1, verse 10, "As Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove." It's an ancient Jewish gloss on the, I think it's on Isaiah 64, "Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down." The commentary on that, the Jewish commentary on that said that God would not speak to his people, that God would be absent from his people until the heavens were torn open. Mark is picking up on that here. Jesus is baptized, the heavens are torn open, and what happens next? God speaks. God is back present with his people. Some versions translate that, "the heavens open." The problem with that is you go to the end of Mark and the temple, when the temple curtain is torn in two, the same Greek word is used. It's only used twice in the Gospel of Mark, and you'd, strictly speaking, then have to translate that the temple curtain was opened, which doesn't really capture what's going on at the temple at that point either. The temple, the curtain is torn open in the same way that the heavens are torn open. So the word of God speaks of God's presence, and one of the things that I wonder that I would suggest is that when the word of God is faithfully preached, God is present in a powerful way with his people. God takes his word proclaimed by his Spirit and is powerfully present with them. So the proclamation of the word of God is not simply an explanation of the Bible, though it should never be less than that. It is also speaks of the powerful presence of God among his people. We'll come back to that. But notice that God's speech, we've already hinted at this, is transformative. When you look at Scripture and see how God's speech functions, God's speech generally transforms. Think of the garden. when the Lord comes and speaks to Adam and Eve in Genesis 3, the word of the Lord is transformative at that point. It shatters their reality. It transforms them. And then you have this ongoing theme throughout Scripture of law and gospel, the commands of God, pointing to what humanity should have been but is not. And the gospel promise is pointing either forward or back to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we have great examples in history of where in the Bible of where God's speech comes and transforms things. Perhaps, again, going back to Luther, I think a key passage in this context for Luther is Pharaoh. You'll know that when Moses confronts Pharaoh, there is a shift over the period of Moses' confrontation with Pharaoh, where Pharaoh hardens himself and then ultimately the Lord hardens him. And the question is, what's going on there? Well, Luther's take is that actually the shift in language is purely phenomenological. That what's going on is the same throughout. When Moses comes and confronts Pharaoh, what does he do? He confronts Pharaoh with God. And when people are confronted with God, what do? They get hardened. So who's doing the hardening? Is it their own hearts? Or is it the God who confronts them? Luther's view is it's both. Confronted with God, unaided by human grace, the sinful heart will naturally harden. Yet it is God who is confronting them, and so God who is hardening their hearts. Luther sees no problem in that text at all. And I think I would, jumping off from that and say, when the word is faithfully preached, transformation happens. It may not be the transformation we're looking for. It may be an incremental hardening rather than an incremental liberating. But it is impossible to be confronted with the word of God and remain the same. I think because this is one of the most challenging things that pastors face when you have people in your congregation who they come week after week and it becomes a question, how do we get through to it? You know, you preach to people week after week and they continue in the same sins. They continue in the same defiance of God. What you see is a hardening, I think. And I think anybody who's been involved in pastoral ministry, any elder can attest to that, that actually people don't stay in the same place. They either move in the right direction or they move in the wrong direction under consistent preaching of the word. And you know, one of the most depressing things as a preacher is preaching, and often you can pick it up even in the body language of the congregation, knowing that the person that you're aiming at, it just isn't having any impact at all. You can make your applications as specific and pointed as you want, and yet they just don't get it. Why not? Because the word is hardening them. They're choosing to be hardened, but the word is hardening them. A few more comments then. So when we come to understanding preaching, I would want to look, you know, where would we go to in the Bible to look at some classic sermons? Well, again, I am very influenced by Peter Adam on this point. I think Peter Adam is right that in some senses the book of Deuteronomy is like the greatest sermon in the Bible in many ways. It is a remarkable example of what a sermon should be. What does Moses do in Deuteronomy? It's his last sermon, the people of God. Well, it's a recounting of the great deeds of God towards his people. The primary focus in Moses' sermon is to tell the people what God is, who God is and what he has done for them. To affirm to them that God is this kind of God. Why is that important? Because the identity of the people of God rests ultimately in the priority of God's identity. Who are we? We are who we are because of who God is. And I think that's the pattern that's picked up by Paul in the New Testament. What does Paul do in the New Testament? Most of his epistles begin with extended statements about the action of God. Because for Paul, it is the action of God which is foundational to the identity of the people of God. Goes back to what I said in the first lecture today. We can get very wrapped up in the pressures that the outside world is placing upon the church, particularly when we seem to be looking at great cultural or political or legal shifts that might be taking place. It can be very easy to allow our identity to be wrapped up in what's going on in the outside world in a reactive kind of way. Paul, of course, is under huge pressure in the first century from the Roman Empire. But Paul's focus is primarily on the history of God with his people. Why? Because that is the foundation for addressing any of the challenges which might come from the outside world. Again, to go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul is explaining there to the Corinthians why Jews react the way they do to the cross and why Greeks react the way they do. But the bottom line is that both categories of people are perishing. And Paul doesn't seem too much in the game of modifying his teaching about the cross to make it more comprehensible to those two categories of people. No doubt if he's speaking to Jews or speaking to Gentiles, that would shape some of the language he would use. But the basic message of the cross is it's the power of God to salvation, and it's the wisdom of God to salvation. So fundamental to Paul, I think, is what's fundamental to Moses, and that is the story of the people of God. I'm not a narrative preacher. But one of the things I think that the narrative guys have really helped with over the last 10, 15, 20, 25 years is stories are important. What did I do when in the last couple of weeks, I've just reached the last 50, 60 pages. After 35 years, I decided to reread The Lord of the Rings. And it was a great book to read coming to New Zealand, and love the movies, and I'm determined to go back, and I'm going to spend a whole day when I get back just watching all the movies with my youngest son, seeing if I can spot Queenstown in any of the sort of shots there. But of course, one of the things about Tolkien that I didn't realize until recently, I read this book called The Fellowship, which is a delightful book on the Inklings. What I hadn't realized till recently was that Tolkien wrote The Lord of the Rings. It was part of a much bigger project he had, and that was to produce a comprehensive English mythology, because he didn't think that the English had a mythology. You know, the Norse peoples have a mythology. There's a great Finnish mythology. The English, we don't have them. We have King Arthur, but it's not quite the same. It doesn't have a sort of creation myth and all these sort of things. And I think what Tolkien understood was that people are shaped by their stories. Don't know if you saw the opening of the 2012 Olympics in England. Yeah, it was interesting. If I did the English story, it would be all about the Battle of Waterloo and beating the French and Lawrence of Arabia and all this kind of stuff and beating the Germans. 2012 was all about the National Health Service. And, you know, I'm a big fan of the National Health Service. It struck me as interesting that that was the national story we chose. You know, can't we do better than this? Can't we have beating the French in there somewhere? You know, as, there are two rugby teams that are hard to lose to as an Englishman. You know, the All Blacks, I accept the fact we're generally going to lose to you guys. But the French and the Welsh, it's very hard to lose to the French and the Welsh. At a stretch, I'd have to, you know, favour losing. If beating the Welsh meant we got to lose to the French, I'd lose to the French. I was actually born on Calcutta Cup Day, and my dad's first words to my mum, because he was a big rugby player, when he went into the room where, in the good old days, the father didn't have to be present, of course. He just walked up and down outside smoking a cigarette, which is what would have been my, without the smoking, would have been my preference. But anyway, my father's first words to my mum when I was born were, "I hope you realize I had to miss the rugby to come in for this." So, and it was a Calcutta Cup Day when England won, by the way. So it was my wife is a Scot, so she didn't like being reminded of that. She was actually born the day after I was in the same year. So she was born the day after Calcutta Cup Day. Maybe Scotland losing pushed her mother. She was born premature. Maybe it was that pushed her mother into premature labor. But anyway, we like stories, don't we? And I think one of the things that reading Deuteronomy does has helped me as a preacher is to understand that part of the task of a preacher each week is to retell to some extent the story of the people of God culminating in the Lord Jesus Christ, because that's foundational. One of the dangers, I think, in the tradition of preaching to which I belong is that we can stop there. We have this big thing at Westminster about, you know, we ground the imperatives in the indicatives. We, generally speaking, rarely get beyond the indicatives, in my experience. We do need imperative preaching, but that has to be rooted, first of all, in that great Deuteronomic emphasis on this is your story. When we teach the Old Testament, we have to teach our people, this isn't just the story of them way back then, this is part of all of those who united to Christ. The story of Old Testament Israel is our story too. The God who delivered on his promises in the wilderness is the God who will deliver on his promises for us today. Another aspect of the Deuteronomic pattern, of course, I think, again, and this moves us from who God is to God's promises, and then to how our response to God should be. I love those bits in the Old Testament law where we're talking about this at the conference this weekend, where the character of God is revealed in his actions. And that's why the church is to have a certain character. Why is the church? What is holiness? Well, holiness is the reflection of God's character. And so often in the history of the church, holiness has been, we've tended to get wrapped up with certain aspects of holiness and not with all of the richness of Old Testament holiness. Hospitality. I'm going to be speaking on Saturday morning on Judges 19, a terrible chapter in Judges about the rape and murder of the second class wife in Judges 19. But central to that chapter is hospitality. Why is hospitality be central to the people of God? Because the God's character. God is the hospitable one. He looks after the widow, the orphan, the sojourner. He does that in the great stories of the Old Testament, and he lays that as an obligation upon his people. Notice too, though, that when Moses speaks to the people, he speaks as God's advocate. But when Moses speaks, the action, if you like, is from God to the people. Who is the agent in Moses' speech to the people? It's God. Now, that's not to say that preachers today are inspired in the way that Moses was inspired. I don't think that if I was, then my sermon should be added to the Bible. Praise God, an act of his grace. They're not added to the Bible. My sermons will contain errors and overstatements and mistakes at points. But when the minister stands in the pulpit and expounds the word of God, it is the word of God which is expounded, not the word of man. And it's the Spirit that takes that word and applies it to the hearts of people. So God is the ultimate agent in the proclamation of the word. Moses speaks for God, and the content of what he says, as he acts as a self-conscious human preacher, the content of what he proclaims is regulated by God's actions towards his people and by God's word. So the content of preaching, and this I think is where P.T. Forsyth is so good, Positive Preaching of the Modern Mind, really it's what he basically says there is, you don't have to worry too much about the world around. Because preaching is about confronting people with Christ. And while it is helpful, it's certainly helpful to contextualize to some extent. For example, if you're preaching to an English-speaking congregation, you want to speak English. And you want to speak in a language with which people are familiar. And you want to draw your examples from things with which they are familiar. But the central content is driven by the Word of God. And it doesn't matter whether you're in Nigeria or Manhattan. The central content should be the same, because the content should be determined by and regulated by God's actions towards his people. Next point. Preaching, and well, we touched on context a little bit, but perhaps say a little bit more on that. Context is important, as I've said, but is ultimately not decisive. One of the examples I like to use when I'm talking about this is Naaman. Naaman has a very specific status in society. He is a high-ranking Syrian officer. And he has a very specific problem. He has leprosy. Probably not modern leprosy as we know it, that I believe emerged much later, but some kind of terrible skin disease. It might have been psoriasis or something like that. What is interesting is that the prophet Elisha just gives him a very generic solution. Naaman comes to see Elisha. Elisha does not respect his rank. and simply sends him off to bathe in the river and get cured. And Naaman's very upset about that, and he won't do it until his servant says to him, why don't you just do what the prophet says? You have nothing to lose. And he does it, and it works. I think one of the things we need to remember about preaching relative to context is this. Context is important, but isn't that important. The human problem is a universal one. Ultimately, the human problem is we're living in defiance of God. And therefore, the solution is a universal one as well. The solution is repent and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. There may be various ways of expressing that, but ultimately, the particulars of context are profoundly relativized by the general nature of the problem and the universal nature of the solution. Again, I would go to 1 Corinthians 1 as another of my texts for that. The response of the culture around us can reveal the moral standpoint, can reveal certain aspects of the specifics of our culture, but the bottom line is it reveals the same moral standpoint and the same eschatological destiny. As Paul says, whether Jew or Greek, they're all perishing. So context then, to be relativized. One thing, and maybe with this I'll sort of draw things to a close and throw it open for questions. So how would I summarize then preaching? If God is the agent in preaching, if preaching is to be regulated by God's saving actions, by his scripture, if preaching is powerful, if human speech is in a sense creative, analogously to God's creation, how would I describe, if I were to describe in one sentence the task of the preacher, how would I describe it? I would say the task of the preacher is to re-describe reality. The task of the preacher is to recreate reality. If you think about the world, what is the world doing? I think it's Greg Beale, one of my colleagues at Westminster, building off David Wells, makes this comment about worldliness. I think it was David Wells wrote it somewhere to the effect that worldliness is anything that makes sin seem normal and the normal seem like sin. What is the world in the game of? I think the world is in the game of preaching to us continually, giving us words that recreate reality in a way that is false. Think about it now. One of the things that struck me, I'm very interested in how people use language. One of the things that struck me just recently in the debate about homosexuality is how the language of flourishing has come to the fore. Even in some of the churches that have switched sides in the United States, City Church San Francisco, one of the big evangelical churches in San Francisco, just switched to be pro-gay. And in the statement they released, they talked about human flourishing. Flourishing is a powerful word. It has a lot of connotations. It's an overwhelmingly good word, because who's opposed to flourishing? It's an interesting use of the term, though, because you can go, you won't find these flagged up or advertised anywhere, but you can go to United States government websites that give you the statistics on sexually transmitted diseases and sexual injuries caused by homosexual activity. And they're catastrophic. I occasionally like to smoke a pipe. It's a convivial thing. I was speaking at a Christian camp last year, and one of my elders and his brother-in-law and myself went and sat on a beach and we lit up our pipes and we got kicked off the beach. This was late at night. Somebody 2 miles away must have seen me light my match and was permanently traumatized by it and kicked me off the beach. If you smoke a pipe in the United States once a year, it's hard to get life insurance. There aren't many companies to give it to you. And yet the health statistics involved in the damage done to your health through smoking your pipe once a year, twice a year, are minuscule. And yet tobacco is banned left, right, and center. And if they didn't need the tax money, it would be illegal. I was at a rock concert a couple of years ago, and I found myself sitting in the audience, and I was suddenly aware that half a dozen people around me had lit up spliffs, marijuana. And I was thinking, I bet if I pulled out a cigar or a cigarette now, I'd be escorted from the building. That there was all these people smoking this illegal stuff. But if you try to smoke tobacco, you're a pariah, you're out. the statistics on homosexual activity health-wise, they're catastrophic. If it was tobacco-related, it would be illegal. We wouldn't be using the language of flourishing. What interests me is the language of flourishing. They call good evil and evil good. The language is being used very, very interesting. It takes me back to my earlier comment about so much of ethics now is aesthetics, because nobody objects to flourishing. But what on earth do you mean by flourishing when you look at the statistics on these things? What is preaching doing? Preaching is redescribing reality as it really is. That's the task of the preacher on Sunday. Going back to what I said earlier on about God's speech being creative, and then looking at the fall and how the serpent, what does the serpent do? The serpent redescribes reality in a way that's false. Luther's very clear on that. The serpent offers an alternative word. What Luther means by that is he offers an alternative description of reality. What is a preacher doing? Preacher isn't just explaining the Bible. The preacher every Sunday is attempting to do 6 days of damage. Because every time you switch on the television, it's like that carbon monoxide in your house. Yeah, we all know about pornography and violence. But what about commercials? What about adverts? What are they telling you? They're telling you, if you buy this, you'll find your full humanity. You'll be fully satisfied as a human being. That's a false reality. The world preaches continually. What is the preacher doing? The preacher's task is ultimately to redescribe reality. And that impacts how we hear. What are we doing when we hear preaching? We're hearing reality being redescribed, and we need to pay attention. Because your preacher grabs you for maybe 30, 35, 40, if you're in John MacArthur's church, maybe 50 minutes. My son is in Washington. He goes to Mark Dever's church. I asked him, so who do you prefer preaching, your dad or Mark Dever? And he said, oh, I prefer you, Dad. And I thought, oh, great, better than Mark Dever. And he said, you only preach for 30 minutes. He said, Dever gives us the full hour. So, well, okay, I'll take the compliment however it comes. You know, even Mark Dever gets his congregation from an hour or maybe 2 hours if you go to evening service a week over against all the preaching that happens continually throughout the week. What is all of this stuff that I've been saying, what does it come down to? Preaching is an attempt to reassert real reality. That's why it's important. You can read the Bible for yourself. You can read commentaries for yourself. One of the things that we do when we read the Bible for ourselves and read commentaries is we always have those filters up that shape how we read. It's far more difficult to have filters up when somebody is looking you in the eye and proclaiming the word to you. When the word comes from outside. Not that you can't use filters, you can. Pharaoh uses a filter when Moses speaks to him, but it's that much more difficult to do when you're confronted. There is a confrontational aspect to preaching that comes out of the fact that preaching is presenting God's story, God's reality, God's truth to people who 6 days a week are slowly but surely being taught that sin is normal and God's normal is sin. Okay, well, that's my hour, I think. I think we've got a quarter of an hour for questions now. Was it 50 minutes for questions? Yeah, straight out the blocks.
Would you like to make a comment about the public reading of the scriptures? I just noticed that the Lord, in Luke 4, went into the synagogue, and all he did was he read the scriptures. I'm wrestling with this here where it says that then he closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. But in verse 21 it says, and he began to say to them, and probably a very, very brief preaching.
Yeah.
I'm not quite sure what you think, if it was more than that, just that one sentence. And he did it from a seat. But would you like to make a comment about the relationship between preaching and the public reading of the scriptures?
Yeah, I think the public reading of scriptures is very important. I think it's something that's been greatly neglected, particularly in Protestant churches. I was brought home to me a couple of years ago two experiences. One, I took a group from my medieval church at Westminster to the local Eastern Orthodox church for a Wednesday service once. A number of students thinking of converting to Eastern Orthodoxy, so I thought the best way to put them off was to take them to see what went on. You know, you're standing up for 2.5 hours for the liturgy of St. John Chrysostom on a Wednesday morning. Makes you think twice about converting to Eastern Orthodoxy. But afterwards, we all went out for lunch, and I asked them, you know, what was good, what was bad, what did you like, what was not so good, what can we learn from, what would we want to try to avoid? And all of them said that the thing that struck the most was the amount of scripture that was read in the service. 3 or 4 chapters of scripture were read in the service. And I had a similar experience when a couple of years ago I was in Cambridge in the UK, and I was an undergraduate there, never went to Evensong at King's College Chapel. I was there with my youngest son, and on the Friday night I said, let's go to Evensong. It's one of the great male voice choirs. Let's go and hear them sing Vespers. So we went to Evensong, and I was struck at how much of the Bible was read and sung in Evensong. Thankfully, there was no preaching, because I'm pretty sure the preaching would have been disastrous at King's. But I was sitting next to a young girl, a very trendily dressed young girl, but was wearing a hijab. So she was a Muslim, I think from Spain. I heard her speaking, I think it was Spanish she was speaking. She was a Spanish Muslim. And I came away thinking, you know, she heard more of God's word spoken than she'd have heard if she'd come to my church on a Sunday. There were 3 Psalms, I think. Whole chapter of the New Testament, whole chapter of the Old Testament read. So I think public reading of the word is something we've tended to neglect in Protestantism. I think it's very important. Paul says, you know, do not neglect the public reading of the word. And of course, in illiterate societies, it was the only way that people got to know the word. But I think there's more to it than that. I think the public reading of the word is very important. Derek Thomas, Presbyterian minister in the United States, this is a big thing. He thinks people read the word too fast in church, and when he reads the word, he really takes time and effort to make sure that he reads it properly. So I do think the public reading of the word is absolutely vital. Preferably whole chapters if you can. Yeah.
In the book Preachers in Preaching, Lloyd Jones, can you give 1 or 2 examples of where you feel like he's kind of off the wall a little bit?
Oh, yeah.
yeah, I mean, the whole unction thing, I think, is... it's completely bonkers. That's not to say that such a thing doesn't exist, but I think any preacher who's preached any of your time will know that there are times when you preach what you think is a really... you know, you really feel empowered in the pulpit, and it hasn't, you know... my wife will shrug her shoulders afterwards and say, was it good this morning? Oh, it was okay. And there are other times when you preach a complete clunker and people will come up to you and say, oh man, that really spoke to me this morning. I think that Lloyd-Jones is, you know, he's very influenced by a particularly experiential Welsh tradition that I think was very confident that it could feel when the Spirit was moving. And I'm from an English... you know, we don't trust our emotions. The only emotions we need to get in touch with are righteous indignation and, on occasion, anger. Those are the only two. And I'm much more suspicious of my feelings than I think Lloyd-Jones is a more, you know, he's an emotional guy drawing on a particularly Welsh mystical tradition. And then that plays over into his theology of revival. You know, he's got that crazy story about the guy who visits the town, and he's arriving on the train, and he feels when he enters the area where the Spirit is kind of pulsating, and then when he gets the train out, he feels when he's left the area of the Spirit. I'm thinking, where do you get that from in the Bible? I mean, maybe he did feel something, but I'm not sure you can make that part of, you can't extrapolate a great public theology from that. It's very subjective. But what I think Lloyd-Jones does well is he really brings out that this is a powerful thing. This isn't just lecturing. It's not just explaining the Bible. This is a powerful thing. And in some ways, the unction thing is the wrong way of getting at the right point. And I think the right point is that preaching the word preached is empowered by the Spirit, and that's a powerful thing. That it's not just, when I lecture in my class, I'm doing something different than when I'm in my church proclaiming God's word. So I think that's what Lloyd-Jones does well. And as I said, I love Lloyd. You know, Lloyd-Jones is one of those guys, everything I get my hands on by him, I read, is always helpful, even when I disagree with him. Working out why he's wrong or why I disagree with him actually helps sharpen your own thinking, I think. But and his use of the word abomination is just magnificent. And, you know, we live in such a polite, politically correct world. It's just great to have somebody who calls it as he sees it. Yeah.
Christopher Ash has written that book, The Priority of Preaching.
Yeah.
And like I was trying to work out the, you know, the role of preaching within the church, and say he, I've understood him right, it's that the written word preached is the practical authority in the church. I'd just be interested to hear your thoughts, and if I've understood that rightly, and if your thoughts about
I haven't read it in depth, and haven't done it. I haven't looked at it for some years now, but I think yes, the what Ash, if I remember rightly, what he's pointing to there is the practical reality that the pulpit sets the tone in a whole heap of ways for the church. A couple of years ago, we've got a number of churches in our presbytery that are dying, and we're always talking about planting churches. And in my mind, there's that question of how do you strike a balance between planting a new church and reviving a dying church. And I got in touch with Mark Dever because the 9 Marks, they don't plant churches, they revive. They try to revive churches. What they do is they find churches that are dying and they try to turn them around. And he wrote me a great, well, it wasn't him, it was one of his minions. So, you know, he has people who do this thing for him, but maybe Jonathan Lehman wrote me a great couple of pages on their strategy. And one of the things I remember from that was he made the point that the pulpit is critical, that one of the things they ask themselves is, can they control the pulpit? If they can't get their guy into the pulpit, there's nothing they can do because the pulpit really does set the tone. And I think that, yes, while in my church, you know, the formal authority is the word of God and then the confessions of the faith, the practical authority is the preaching. And I'm aware that if I preach in a very bitter way, I'm going to create a bitter congregation. If I preach in a way with no imperatives, then I have a congregation without any commitment. So I do think that thinking about your preaching in terms of my preaching sets the foundation for what the church will be like is very important, because that's what most people hear and most people care about. Most people are not reading the confession. Most people are not at my church because they're conviction Presbyterians. It's the preaching that is going to be shaping their the way they think about church and the way they think about their lives. So this is why it's important, I think, to make sure that, you know, if I was to ask what's the biggest problem in the church today, I'd say too many men who aren't really called to preach are preaching. One of the problems, I think, in Presbyterianism, conservative Presbyterianism in the United States is we've rightly reacted against the very democratic approach that evangelicalism has of every member ministry. I believe every member has a ministry, but that doesn't mean preaching ministry isn't important. The problem when you can end up exalting the preaching ministry in a way that makes people think they have to be a minister in order to be doing anything useful for the kingdom. And when that occurs, what happens is you get people going into the ministry who shouldn't be in the ministry. So you get men in the pulpit who can't preach. And, you know, if you can't, at the most basic level, if you can't stand up behind a pulpit and string a decent English sentence together, it doesn't matter how godly you are, how much theology you know, you're not called to be a preacher. And one of the big problems in the church is we don't have a lot of good preaching. We really don't. And I don't think it's that hard to be a decent, I mean, not everybody's going to be Martin Lloyd-Jones or Charles Haddon Spurgeon, but I don't think it's that hard to be a decent preacher, to expand the Bible and apply it in a way that has that people find helpful and has an impact on them. And yet we seem to find it incredibly difficult to find those people and put them in pulpits.
I'll probably be embarrassed after you give the answer to this, because I should know church history better, but
it'd be embarrassing. If I can't give the answer, I'd be far more embarrassed than you.
Well, let me rethink my question. We know that we learn a lot from history, obviously. But has there ever been in the history of the church a place where the church from the biblical church, as it were, from a very prominent position moved into, in a short period of time, to where we are at now? So in other words, is there a precedent in history for what we are experiencing right now?
Right.
So the biblical evidence, you know, I understand what you're saying about us being in exile.
Yeah.
And if that's the case, you know, what are the things that we can apply now?
It's a good question. I'm guessing that if you look at certain some of the revolutions of the 20th century, the Russian Revolution, the Chinese Revolution, I don't know much about the Protestant churches in those nations when the revolutions happened, but they would have been very, very quick transformations. I do think that the what we're experiencing now is it's happened breathtakingly fast. I mean, the irony of the Supreme Court decision in the United States last week was, you know, 5 years ago, nobody could find gay marriage in the Constitution. Now, apparently, it's been there all along. Yeah, that's what the judgment is effectively saying. I think the speed at which sexual identity politics has moved has been dramatic. And I've been trying to say in the church for some time now, you know, gay marriage, that's done for most, you know, people of my kids' generation, that's done. And it was done a few years ago. My generation are catching up on how things have already changed, and the penny is just starting to drop. Historically, even in Bible times, think about, I'm preaching on Sunday on the she-bears savaging 42 boys in 2 Kings. Bethel, Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, sets up the idols, and it's done very quickly. So I think the speed is not unprecedented. It's very disorienting. What is perhaps disorienting today, even more than some of the political stuff, is the rapid transformation of ethical questions. I suspect the most challenging ethical questions I'm not going to get in my church are not going to be on the gay or transgender front. It's going to be somebody coming to me and asking me about what do I think about surrogate pregnancies, or this medical procedure, or that medical procedure. I think the whole world of medical ethics is complicated now in an unprecedented way. We've never seen that. We've not noticed that so much because we've been absorbed with the bigger social issues. But there are ethical issues relative to fertility and things like that that are likely to come up in congregations far more than transgenderism, for example, that I don't even know where to begin. It's not that I think the Bible is insufficient for these things. Of course it's sufficient for them. I just don't know how to get from the biblical text to a biblical answer to some of these questions. So I think that we do live in unprecedented times in terms of the complexity of ethical questions that are now being asked. It's not simply on the gay, transgender front, but on fertility, stem cell research, all of these things, just incredibly complicated. And it's hard to look back in history and find any help at this point.
Yes, looking at you, going back to your comments on readings, it just seems to me wherever I go that music seems to have pushed prayer and readings out of out of the services a lot,
yeah.
And particularly self-centered type music, yes. Rather than God-centered. Any comments? I mean, prayer seems to be. I had a guy who was a worship leader in a church say no. We should be here to worship prayer. That should be in prayer groups during the week.
Yeah.
He wanted it shoved out of the services.
I think some of this is a result of a failure to sort of reflect on the liturgy of worship. And by liturgy, I don't necessarily mean a written prayer book. I mean just the structure of worship. I'm very fortunate. In my denomination, some of those decisions are made for me. So in my Sunday service, there are certain elements that have to be there every Sunday. We have to have a call to worship. We have a prayer for God's blessing on worship. We will then have a prayer of confession, followed by a declaration of the gospel, which we'll be reading a passage of scripture. Then there'll be a prayer for God's people. And then either before or after or both, the preaching of the word, there'll be a prayer for the preaching. So in the denomination to which I belong, the General Assembly has made a determination that there have to be those prayer elements in the service. I think quite often what happens in churches which are not denominationally affiliated and don't have that sort of structure, sometimes you get very enthusiastic and well-meaning, often younger people in positions of leadership, who they think of liturgy as the enemy of spontaneity. I'm not sure that spontaneity is ever lauded in the Bible as a virtue anyway. Paul talks about a form of sound words. That doesn't sound very spontaneous to me. And of course, if you sing a hymn or a song or a chorus, somebody else wrote it. So there's a limit to the spontaneity of the tune and the hymn you sing anyway. But I think that there's this feeling that if we have a formal structure, then somehow our worship is less authentic, or we're not with the Spirit, or something like that. And that, I think, has tended on the whole to lead to downplaying of prayer and the rise of sort of praise band music. I want to be careful because when talking about music styles, I am aware that there is a lot of personal taste in what we like as music in worship. So I want to be careful that I don't sound as if I'm sort of damning all contemporary worship music. But I do think there's been a shift in a lot of church services to having more music and less prayer and less Bible reading. Of course, one way to have your cake and eat it on that front is to have the songs you sing saturated in God's Word. In my church, we sing everything from the Psalms to the Gettys in my church, but we always have one or at least two Psalms every worship service. So when we sing, we are also singing the word of God. So there are various ways of addressing that. I've been sort of a bit... I only came across Hillsong recently. And there was this video YouTube thing that was sent to me where a couple of guys, I assume they're Australian, stand up and say, "You ready for the word?" And everybody says, "Yes." And then a kind of brass band dressed in British busbies come in sort of dancing, and it's not the word, it's a brass band playing. And that sort of left me thinking, well, what do we think of as the word? I don't know how influential this group is, but if your idea of the word is it's a brass band playing, then that would make the situation you described even worse than it is.
But it's often almost used as an escapism from the reading and the prayer.
I think the reading and prayer have to be central. But you know, singing is important too. Just make sure you sing good stuff. Even if it's contemporary, make sure it's good stuff and not mindless stuff. Yeah.
Just a question. In your first lecture, you made a comment along the lines that the church should be the most dangerous place for people.
Yeah.
Words to that effect.
Yeah.
I just wonder if you could expand on that or explain it a little.
Well, it was in the context of this article by Andy Stanley. And I think what Andy Stanley was... I think if he'd said it 10 years ago, I wouldn't be as suspicious as I am today. I think the world is a pretty safe place for gay people by and large, and it's getting less safe for those who are critical of the gay movement. So I read Andy Stanley's article very much as a stepping stone towards what I would see as a major... concession on the issue. What I meant by the church should be a dangerous place is, I think what people mean these days when they talk about safe places is places where you can go and be affirmed and not criticized, not have to hear opinions which you find offensive or with which you disagree. I don't think the church should be that place. I think the church is the place where you need to have your illusions torn away from you. As I've said in the second lecture, where you need to hear reality described in a true way rather than a false way. So the reason why I would not write a response saying, no, the church needs to be a dangerous place for gay people, is you know what the media will immediately grab hold of that and say, pastor says church should be dangerous for gays, and then you're done. What I would want to say is the church should not be a place where anybody, heterosexual, homosexual, gay, straight, whatever, the church should not be a place where anybody goes and is simply affirmed and confirmed in who they are when they walk through the door. That's not what the church should be. I actually think using the language of danger and safety is unhelpful, but it's the language these people, you know, people like Andy Stanley have chosen to use. I didn't choose to use that language. I think it's unhelpful. Certainly, I want my church to be a place where we once a year, as part of our outreach, we do a thing where I sit in the park, a local park, in a rocking chair and read a Narnia book. Then we just hand out Bibles and chat to people afterwards. And we always get gay people turn up and sit and listen. And sometimes they'll come into church and we have good chats with them. And I certainly want my church to be a place where I don't care who you are. I don't care what your sexual preference is. You can come and be treated like a human being, my church. I want you to be welcomed. if you're a divorcee, if you're gay, if you're an ex-offender, I want you to come to my church and I want you to feel welcomed and not looked down upon. So I'm certainly not saying I want the church to be a place that treats you like a piece of scum when you walk through the door. I want my church to be a welcoming place. But I also want my church to be a place where you're going to hear that you can't make it on your own. And you might be really righteous in your identity, and that's a problem. You need to repent and turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's why, again, to go back to the problem of ethics as aesthetics is, when somebody writes, I want the church to be a safe place for category X of people, it's hard to disagree. Because you do want the church to be a welcoming place for people of all kinds. But once the language of safety, like the language of flourishing, has been hijacked for a particular political cause, you know, you're left in the invidious position of saying, well, no, I don't want the church to be a safe place. And that sounds horrible. Or I don't want human beings to flourish. That sounds really, really horrible. But I do want the church to be a welcoming place for anybody, a Christian or non-Christian, to come. So I apologize if I sounded as if I wanted the church to be unfriendly. I don't want the church to be an unfriendly place at all.
Yeah.
You talked earlier about the church not having done a particularly good job of, I guess, being a carbon monoxide sensor in terms of what's going on in the culture.
Mm.
One thought that springs to mind in response to that is that if we are driven by the topics of the day, that would exacerbate that problem, where if we're expositing the gospel, we're less likely.
Yeah.
Can you comment on that?
No, I think that sounds absolutely correct to me. I think you faithfully expound the word of God week by week. You can trust the Spirit of God to apply that word to people's hearts. I mean, if you're faithfully expounding, you know, do you know how many times I've mentioned gay marriage in my pulpit in the last 4 or 5 years? I think twice. I mean, you might be able to go onto my website and find that I've done it 3 or 4 times. I don't know. But it's a small handful of times. I've written about it quite a lot. I write for a website in the United States, First Things, which is very much engaged with sort of freedom of religion kind of issues. So in terms of freedom of religion, I've written about it quite a lot because of its implications of freedom of religion. I don't preach on it that often because it doesn't come up in the text that often. And I don't want my preaching to be driven by the context so much as the text. Now, last couple of weeks, I did allude to the Supreme Court, coming Supreme Court decision. Why? Because I didn't want my people panicked by it. I don't want people to think, oh, the Supreme Court have decided this, everything's going to change. It's a sense in which, no, you're going to wake up on Saturday morning and, you know, gas is going to cost the same. Nothing's going to change. Things may change significantly over time, but we need to be prepared for some change, but we also need not to panic. God's still in control. The Supreme Court can't put Jesus' body back in the tomb. They have limits to their power. So I'll allude to it in that sort of context, but by and large, I try to allow my preaching to be governed by the text. Partly because I don't want to fall prey to the, you know, one of the world's criticisms is, oh, you Christians are all obsessed with gay marriage. Well, no, we're just having to constantly respond to it because you're obsessed with it and keep asking us our opinion on it. But I do want the text to drive, and I think the best way to have a balanced ministry is to preach through whole books of the Bible and allow the text to carry you. Now, obviously, when it comes to applications, there's going to be more specific in your applications, but allow the text to carry you. Sometimes I think there's a place for thematic sermons. I've been talking with my elders about, should I do a short series on human sexuality? Because some of the young people, I'm pretty sure that they may be well confused by what's going on now. There may be a case at times where you need to do a short sermon series, but I think by and large, whole books of the Bible. And again, I've just alluded to it, comes through, this is where elders are important. I also think the minister should be consulting his elders about what he preaches, the applications he makes, taking their advice. Quite often when I come to the end of a sermon series, I'll go to my elders and I'll say, you know, there are 2 books in mind to preach on. What do you think? Which one would be best for the congregation, given what we know is going on? So I think there are all kinds of ways that one can nuance the context, but preaching the word consistently is a good way of avoiding getting hung up on the world's obsessions. I mean, I hate these days they sometimes have in America where you're told, you know, you got to preach on abortion this Sunday. And I say, no, I got to preach on God's word this Sunday. If the text throws it up, I'm going to preach on abortion, obviously. but I'm not going to take a, I'm not going to suddenly deviate from my regular ministry, because for most of my people, they need the steady diet of the Word.
So just confirmation, you talked about, this is a little bit peripheral, but you talked about if the tax advantages of the churches are taken away, that would be pretty much the end of a lot of the major churches. Could you explain?
Yeah. Well, if the churches in the United States are not-for-profits or charities, as they would be called in Britain, which means we don't pay tax. And it also means that the donations given to the church are tax deductible. So if you take away tax advantages, I think two things. One, the church would have to pay tax. And secondly, people would give less because it's going to hurt, you know, they're not going to get a tax deduction for their gifts. So it's like it would be like a double tax on the churches. Church like mine, we are... our budget's about $180,000. I'm guessing that's probably about $240,000, $250,000 New Zealand dollars. I could see that significantly dropping. Now I do it part time and pay me very much. I could continue to sort of do what I do, but it would be hard to pay rent on a building. It would be hard to do some of the things we do. Ironically, you know, it would be hard. We have a deacons fund. We do a lot in our community. We give a lot of our deacons money to people who aren't members of our church, poor people in the community. Ironically, because of our views on gay marriage, which frankly doesn't affect us in the slightest in the way we operate week by week, poor people in our neighborhood will suffer because we'll be decided we're no longer an organization that operates for the benefit of wider society and therefore cannot be a charity. Westminster, I think it would just finish us straight off, because all of our money is donation money. We depend on a number of large donors giving money. I think we would be crushed fairly quickly by the withdrawal of tax exemptions. I don't know the exact figures. And my wife and I, you know, we tithe, so we'd probably just continue to, it would be painful, but we'd just suck it up. But I don't think that everybody in my church, I don't know who gives what anyway, but I don't think everybody in my church would be able to afford to just suck it up.
So it's time for
lunch. So we reconvene at